Hey programmers, last week we started talking about sequences, and we can't talk about what's new in sequences without talking about what's new in tracking. Because you're already a grandMA2 programmer, I don't have to waste any time explaining what tracking is. Instead, we're just gonna focus on the new options in grandMA3, stuff like new sequence options, the copy queue options, and tracking distance. First off, remember how the fixture sheet was also the channel sheet? Well, the sequence window is also our tracking sheet. Just click Track Sheet at the top of the window. And yep, you can absolutely make edits within this sheet. When the calculator pops up, you can choose to make your current edit queue only here, or if you just want to be staying in queue only, you can turn that mode on here at the top of the window. Also at the top in the settings options, if you need to turn off tracking for an entire sequence, that option's here. Let's look back in the sequence sheet and talk about release and assert. These options have everything to do with tracked values. With release on, tracked values will be automatically released. Let's take a look at this sequence where I only have intensity, position, and color on these lights in Q1. In Q2, the only value I'm storing is a new color. If I clear out and then play them back, tracking gives us what we expect in Q2. We see the color change and everything else remains. If I turn on release for Q2, then play back from Q1 into Q2, my lights turn off and go back to their default position. The color changed, but the tracked values got released. I think of this option as a way to selectively turn off tracking for the sequence beginning at the queue of my choice. I also think that this is an option that I will not get much use out of. You may have noticed that my first queue has release on by default, and why that is isn't really immediately obvious. This has to do with when you're wrapping around in your sequence and playing from the last queue into the first queue. In the settings options, if release first queue is on, then you'll see release on your first queue. If you were to toggle it off, that release goes away. Let's take a look at an example to see the difference. I'm leaving the release on in Q1, and I'm going to add a strobe into Q2. We didn't add any strobe values in Q1, so when I hit go and wrap back around to Q1, that strobe is going to go away because we're releasing the tracked values. If I turn off release first queue, then I can play back from my last queue into my first queue and the values are going to track. The assert option comes into play when you're playing multiple queue lists that have control over the same attributes. If you want tracked values to have a precedence over control from any other sequence that may also be running when you trigger this queue with a go plus, then you want to have assert set to yes. As an example, I'm going to take these same lights and put them in a new position, and then store just that position information to a second sequence. Okay, I'm in Q1 on my original sequence, and now I'm going to play Q1 on the second sequence that I just created. And latest takes precedence, so my lights move to that new position. Now remember, Q2 in my original sequence only has information on color and strobe. The position was a tracked value, so if I play Q2, the lights stay in that new position for my second sequence. Let's do this again, but this time with assert set to yes on Q2. Okay, I'm playing Q1 in my original sequence. Now I'll play Q1 in my second sequence. The lights move just like we expect. But now when I play Q2 on my original sequence, the tracked position value will be asserted. It's sort of like a mini high priority setting for an individual queue. There's also this Q0. Okay, so we had Q0 as an option in grandMA2, but here in this version of software, it's just going to be automatically inserted. I don't know if this will become optional in future versions or just always be present. Either way, just think of Q0 as a container for all of your light's default values. When you go to copy the state of a queue along with default values that maybe weren't stored into the queue, it's this Q0 that the console references when it puts those default values into the copied queue. It's really more for the console's benefit than it is for ours. And I'll be honest, in my main sequences, I'll always store a setup queue that contains a clean start preset along with all of the attributes that I need to mark. And if you also make this part of your practice, the Q0 really won't affect you either. And since we're on the topic of copying queues, let's check out the new options there. I'm going to switch to the tracking sheet so that we can see exactly what it does. First, let's talk about copying cues to new cues in our sequence. Then we'll talk about copying cues to existing cues. I've got a really simple cue list with two fixtures in it. In Q1, I've got unit 1 at full, but unit 2 at 0. I've got some color parameters for both units in Q2. Q3 only changes the intensity of unit 1. And in Q4, I change the zoom value of both of my units from their default to 25%. Say I want to copy Q3 to Q5. In the pop-up, let's start with Copy Source Options, which is telling the console what attributes we want to be able to pull from our source queue, which remember is Q3. Content would allow us to copy only the values that we actually stored in the source queue. In our case, just that intensity value on unit 1. Status allows us to copy values and tracked values from that original queue, so we'd get the intensities and colors for both of our units. And if you were looking for a grandMA2 style status copy, this is the option that you want to pick. I know that the option below that says copy status seems like it would be the same, but it is not. We'll get there in a minute. Look is sort of like status, but it's going to copy attributes in two different ways depending on whether the light's intensity is above 0 or at 0. In Q3, we've got unit 1 at 50% and unit 2 at 0. So if we were going to copy Q3 to Q5 using look, we'd see that the fixture whose intensity was above 0 is copied with all values and tracked values included. Any fixture like our unit 2 whose intensity is at 0 will have their intensity copied, but that's it. It allows everything else to track from the previous queue. And for both of our fixtures, any attribute that was left at its default, like our zoom value, remains untouched in the copied queue. Let me delete that copied queue and try something else. Down at the bottom, our options are copy, or copy status, or cancel. We've already used copy, and cancel works as you'd expect, but this middle copy status option has to do with how tracked and default values are dealt with. It also works in tandem with this release option above. Let's say our source is content, and then we choose copy status. We get the values from the source queue copied to the destination, but with the tracked values, they're turned into their defaults, and any value that was already at its default in the source queue also gets stored with a hard default value on it. Let me delete it and let's try it again. Still setting our source as content, and this time I want to check release and then hit copy status. Now any tracked values and any default values from our source queue are now set to release in the destination queue. That example was with content as our source. Let's delete that copied queue and do the same thing but change to status as the source. I'm leaving release on and then I'm clicking status copy. We get our status copy for the values stored in the source queue along with tracked values, but the attribute that was at its default in the source queue gets set to release in the destination queue. So if you're with me that far in copying options, let's say that we wanted to copy over an existing queue. If I try to copy Q3 to Q4, my pop-up would have slightly different buttons. My source options still work the same, and because there's another queue following my destination queue, I can choose queue only if I don't want the changes to track. But down below, now I can choose to merge or overwrite. Merge is going to work as we'd expect from grandMA2, and I would think of this overwrite content option just as overwrite, again like grandMA2. The overwrite status option is new, and it's similar to the copy status we just talked about, so let's pick that. It's turned my tracked values into hard default values. It's also deleted my zoom parameter because it's an overwrite. Let me oops that out, and this time we'll add in release with our overwrite status. So my intensity value gets copied, but my track values get turned into releases. And just for fun, let's oops that out and try one more option. I want to leave this on content and also release, but I'm going to add in queue only and hit overwrite status. My contents are copied, my tracked values are released, but all is restored and back to the look of Q3 and Q5 because we did that as queue only. And I know I didn't show you an example of inserting or deleting a queue, but that's because the option to do these queue only or not are exactly the same. There is one other change when it comes to copying a range of queues. In MA3, the console will try to recreate the numeric structure of the source in the destination. For example, if I said copy Q2 and 4 at Q6, my destination queues are Q6 and 8. The console allowed for the gap between the whole numbers. This is kind of nice because the console will now make it so that whenever possible, we'll recreate the numeric structure and also try to avoid all of those long decimal point queue numbers that we'd sometimes get in grandMA2. I'm not gonna lie, trying to remember how every new copy option can affect every other copy option can be a little confusing. So let's give our brains a break and switch to talking about tracking distance instead. This is a completely new option in our sequence sheet that's really just a quick way to tell attributes stored into a queue to only track for a certain amount of queues in your sequence. It's a bit like storing these attributes queue only through a set amount of queues and then unblocking. In this example, I've told some lights to be at full in Q1, then in Q2, I give them a color, in Q3, their intensity is set to 50, and in Q4, their intensity goes to full. All other attributes have been untouched, so they're sitting at their defaults. Now, if I decide that I want the color that I stored in Q2 to track only as far as Q3, I would click the tracking distance in Q2 and set this to a queue number of 3. So now that color tracks through Q3, and I can tell which values are tracked using tracking distance because they'll have this white line around them. And in Q4, it gets released back to its default because I didn't have any other value on color in Q1. If I was now to add a new color preset in Q1 and merge it, you can see that in Q4, we go back to the color that was in Q1. Again, sort of like if I had stored the queue in Q2 and 3 as queue only. One of the things you do have to remember with tracking distance is that it's not ever going to track data over attributes that you've stored a value to in a queue. See, my intensity value in Q3 is not overwritten by any sort of tracked value from Q2. It also means if I manually store a new color to one of these fixtures in Q3, tracking distance will not override that. The best way to see what tracking distance is doing is to watch these white markers in the tracking sheet. There is another option in the tracking distance column that allows you to set a delta of queues. So if I set this same queue to a delta plus 1, I'd get the same results. The values stored in this queue will track forward one queue, and that's it. Next week, let's talk about the hardware executors that we can associate with our sequences. Thanks for watching.